Ed Hardy and Michael Ford are coming. Ellen Wilkinson, the red flag, she is humming. We get around not as much as Dominic Cummings, even though he's driving blind. We are the River Grassroots, where like-minded folk dwell. From countryside to city, it's warm and it's witty, the antidote to Pretty Patel. We are the River Grassroots, time to raise a racket. The future is as bright as Crispin's red jacket. It's into space where we all go hell for leather, free from all the biased BBC blether. Like track and trace, we're better together, just ask Harry and Meg. Yeah, we got all the people from Inverness, Skegness, Farrow, Inverness, Chester, Leicester, Cirencester, Shrewsbury, Oswald Street, Swansea, Fernachley, Barnsley, Beckles, Nottingham and Eccles. We are the Labour grassroots, time to plant some grass. Yeah, we've always had social distancing between us and the upper class.
Welcome to Castaway with John McDonnell. John, are you there, John?
Hi, I'm not quick enough, I'm on muting. Hi, Crispin, good to see you.
Good to see you, John. We're doing 1 hour with your favourite seven songs and three books that you've chosen. It's a difficult thing to choose few number, but you did, eventually. The first song that you've chosen is Gil Scott Heron.
You will not be able to stay home, brother. You will not be able to plug in, turn on, and cop out. You will not be able to lose yourself on Skag and skip out for beer during commercials because the revolution will not be televised. The revolution will not be televised. The revolution will not be brought to you by Xerox in four parts without commercial interruptions. The revolution will not show you pictures of Nixon blowing a bugle and leading a charge by John Mitchell, General Abrams, and Spiro Agnew to eat hog maws confiscated from a Harlem sanctuary. The revolution will not be televised. The revolution will not be brought to you by the Schaefer Award Theater and will not star Natalie Woods and Steve McQueen or Bullwinkle and Julia. The revolution will not give your mouth sex appeal. The revolution will not get rid of the nub. The revolution will not make you look 5 pounds thinner because the revolution will not be televised, brother. There will be no pictures of you and Willie Mae pushing that shopping cart down the block on the dead run or trying to slide that color TV into a stolen ambulance. NBC will not be able to predict the winner at 8:32 on report from 29 districts. The revolution will not be televised.
Right, so what was your reason for choosing that song? I mean, I've looked it up and it was a groundbreaking song, and he was only 21 when he recorded it, apparently. So is there a particular part significance for that?
Lots of reasons, really. Politically, because a lot of my generation's politics stemmed from the liberation movements around the world, but also the campaigns that were going on in terms of black civil liberties and black rights in America. And it's so, you know, Jackson, Angela Davis, all of those people who were standing up heroically and courageously against racism and oppression in the belly of the beast of capitalism, basically. And some of them, like Angela Davis and others, others going to prison. And Gil Scott Heron emerged. It's now looked upon as the father of rap. So he literally had his own style. This is the first time someone stood up and sang like that, spoke like that. And he was just, and also so directly political. Up until then, there have been political songs, but they'd largely been couched in sort of poetic language. Gil Scott Heron comes along, says, boom, that's it. The revolution will not be televised. You will have a, you won't be able to hide from this struggle, basically. And he was phenomenal. And I'll name drop, shall I? One of my friends, Ramona, actually had a relationship with him for a period. And then when he came over here, Cynthia, my wife and I, we went and saw him at, I think it was the Jazz Cafe. And his pianist, we got to know quite well, she was brilliant. And I just, it's embodied for me how you can use music it really directly and motivationally. And he became a motivating force. He's dead now. He went in and out of prison as well. Ironically, we hadn't seen him. He hadn't been to this country for a couple of years. And he had a concert on the South Bank. So we booked tickets and we all went along. And then just as Gil Scott Heron came on and he started playing, there was a protest. And I looked behind me and I saw lots of my friends from the King's Cross Women's Centre and all the rest. And they were protesting because he'd booked a concert in Israel. And we were launching the boycott campaign at that stage. So they all stood up and protested. And I bought all these tickets and whatever. I thought, oh, I'm so looking forward to this. In the end, I said, I can't stick around. So I joined them and got thrown out as well, basically. But then, Gil Scott, I don't know who he was, agent or manager was, but Gil Scott Heron got up and said, I'm not going to Israel. And he cancelled that whole tour. It was quite phenomenal. And he made an extremely strong political point as a result of that as well. Tragically, he was in that prison, had real drug problems, etc. He's dead now, but I think his music will live forever. And it was so direct, and it motivated a whole generation of young black artists as well to get engaged in political activity, but also to use their voices through music and a whole range of engagement and, you know, entertainment and artistic performance to motivate people and mobilize them politically. So I think it was a huge breakthrough. And it went on, rap then developed. He's looked upon as I said, the father of rap. And in some instances, I think he most probably is. But he was part of that movement. I think people underestimate the struggles that went on during that time that led into the Panthers and et cetera, in trying to really challenge the oppressive nature. And we've seen it revive now in Black Lives Matter. And I think the Black Lives Matter movement has been phenomenally world-changing, global-changing in terms of our attitudes around the issues, but also how we mobilize as well. And seeing that new generation on the streets and mobilizing so effectively, putting issues back on the agenda again, not just in America, but globally, has been tremendous. And it's interesting how many artists now who've associated themselves with Black Lives Matter refer back to Gil as well. Yeah, incredibly exciting character. You never knew not what he was going to do next in terms of music, but he was just absolutely phenomenal. You know, when you went to one of his concerts, he was a life force. He really was, you know, and he engaged with the audience all the time as well. And he was a brilliant musician, but he attracted around him brilliant musicians as well because of that excitement overall. Yeah, no, it was just terrific music.
I could tell he's made a big impression on you because we're running over time now. I'm going to move on. So your second track, song that you've chosen is Jamie Webster, This Place, which I'm just going to play now.
Sure.
This is where I'm from. Familiar faces and the accents like a song. Cause I've been traveling places that I don't belong. I'm spending days of being a stranger. Time's lost when you're out of range. Without the hustle and bustle, but it all seems quite deranged. But when I think about the beds in Georgia's all, and when he tried to knock us down and we stood up. So this city will forever be me saving grace. So no matter where I am, I'll raise a glass to this place. So raise your glass to this place. divvy in a bib and blaze. You're ahead of the pace, and you'd owe it all to this place. So raise your glass to this place. The night goes on forever, there's loads of doubts to go. You'd ask me how I'm feeling, I'll tell you tomorrow.
So, Jamie Webster, This Place was released in 2020. There is a version with Liverpool Football Club all over it, but I thought I'd leave it with that one. So does this remind you of Liverpool? What's the significance of Jamie Webster's song? How does it get to you?
You didn't like the one with the Liverpool Football Club all over it then, Crispin, did you?
Hey? No, it was just it had too much scoring goals over it.
I thought that might be the case, yeah. People know I was born in Liverpool, but my family moved south when I was a kid, and I've always felt myself as a Scouser, because when we moved from Liverpool, I was always told we were going on holiday, and I kept asking, when are we going home? And we never did. And I was really, that's why I have such an affinity with the city itself, because I've always felt myself to be a Scouser, a Liverpool supporter. And actually, the worst thing you could do, Crispin, is just say choose seven. Because after I'd sent you the list I had, I'd forgotten about Sean Taylor as well, because he does a brilliant You'll Never Walk Alone, as well as all the other blues songs he does. He's brilliant. Anyway, Jamie, people need to know more about Jamie Webster. He's the sort of, he's the songster of the cop in terms of Liverpool. He sings all the Liverpool songs at the matches and in various concerts and things like that. And he's absolutely terrific. But he's also, all the work he does has a strong political analysis as well. And I think he does it brilliantly. And he has a sense of pride in being a Liverpudlian. He gets that across. But also, if you look at some of his work as well, he depicts the tough times that Liverpool have been through, but also the way in which solidarity and the strength of that Liverpool community has seen them through. And of course, yeah, he associates that a bit with football, but it's more generally with the city itself. And I'm trying to say to people, you need to look at his work. It's really good. And he's like a modern day troubadour for the city. And I think he's becoming increasingly well known. He works with a group and they do videos which are just terrific, absolutely terrific. And his recent ones have been about the politics that's going on in terms of what's happening in Liverpool, and the way it's been treated over the years and the way in which people can fight back. So no, in addition to the football songs as well, and the songs like this, which are about the sense of community, the sense of pride of a Liverpudlian, but also it's the politics of that community fighting back, and how it has done over the years, the way it's been treated by the British state has been absolutely appalling. The exploitation of people, the poverty that's been enforced upon them, the injustices that have been meted out to them, but they've come through it. And Jamie sums that up in a number of his songs. He's a very young lad, but his concerts are unbelievable. When people are on their feet straight away, and he's got a huge following now, which is tremendous. I think you're muted, Crispin.
He's on the call, I was just going to say. He's here, Jamie's here, and I just see if he's unmuted now. Are you there, Jamie?
Yeah, I'm here.
There he is, look.
John, thank you very much for all the words you just said there. It means a lot, mate. I bet you're blushing a little bit now, but honestly, thank you very much.
That's a trick. Crispin never told me. Good to see you, Jamie. Anyway,
yeah, good to see you. I didn't know whether to drop you a little message, but he said he wanted to keep it a surprise, so I thought I'd go with his wishes. But
Well, on all of these things, you know, if you're going to do something about Liverpool, it's always either the Beatles or You'll Never Walk Alone or whatever. But I thought actually that song sums it up really well. It's terrific. And I've said it, you know that anyway. I think you need to be but wider known. And you begin to pick up, which is really good. I think your videos are great too. I really do.
Oh, no, John, really, I appreciate it. It's nice to hear you say all that, honestly, it is. And hopefully, once we get out the back of what's going on at the minute, it will be a little bit wider known because I've got another album just like the first ready to go near enough. So it's all hands on deck once we're allowed to. But thanks very much again, John. Really appreciate it.
Yeah, once you can get back to the concerts and all the rest of it, that'd be tremendous. So the tours and stuff like that. When's the next album roughly out?
It'll probably be around the time that we're hoping to be on for this, so maybe around August, September, maybe even October time. Just going to probably summarise the feelings of myself and people around me throughout this, since the last one dropped really, which was sort of in the middle of this pandemic. Mm-hmm. So I'm looking forward to it. I'm looking forward to seeing what the people think of it. And yeah, like I say, thanks.
Should be coming out just after we've won the Champions League again. That'll be ideal.
That's what we want to hear, John. That's what we want to hear. But let's hope we can sort ourselves out now. I've got the Man City game on at the same time now, and I'm gutted that they're winning 1-0 at the minute. You might not be happy to be here, nearly two. But yeah, no, honestly, thank you very much. It's been great listening to you talk, and
thanks.
Love the Gil Scott Heron as well. I love Gil Scott Heron myself, so it's right on that. Thanks very much, Crispin.
Thanks for coming on, Jamie. And John, we've got your next song is the Style Council, which I'm going to play now. Oh no, that's the wrong one. Oh, this is complicated here. Hold on, here we go.
You're doing brilliantly, Chris.
There is a cost, his broken skull and leather cosh, from the boys in uniform. Now you know whose side they're on. With backing, with blessing from earthly gods, not heaven, a stone's throw away to it. Whatever pleasures those who get from stripping skin with rhino whip are the kind that must be stopped before that kind take all we've got. With loving, with caring, they take great pride in working the stones throw away.
That's A Stone's Throw Away, recorded in 1985. It obviously brings back memories of the miners' strike. So what was your reason for choosing that particular song, John?
When I left school, I was on the shop floor and then eventually did night school and went to university. When I came out of university, my first job was with the National Union of Mine Workers. And it was an education in trade unionism as a full-time officer. And then when we went into the miners' strike, I then moved on to the TUC, but I was on the GLC at the time. And obviously during the miners' strike, I was doing, like everyone else in the movement, I was doing everything I possibly could to support the miners. I was on picket lines, demonstrations. We were raising money, literally, even now, it was like raising food and sending it up to Yorkshire and Wales, the Kent field as well. And I was on the GLC, and it was just before we were campaigning in the run up to the rate capping campaign. And we were doing everything we could to support the NUM. And one of the ideas was working with the union. I was chair of finance on the GLC and deputy leader. One of the ideas we had is that we could fund a whole series of fundraising concerts. So one of them was we booked the Royal Albert Hall for a concert, a fundraising concert, and Style Council immediately volunteered and played. And they were, Paul Weller was phenomenal. He still is. He did a concert for us in Brighton not long back. And he's the man's a genius, musician, absolutely brilliant in terms of his ideas, his concepts, and how he brings people together. And it was a heaving, absolutely packed Royal Albert Hall. And they were one of the acts, and they were just phenomenal. Dennis Skinner got up and sang. He sang, he brought the audience to absolute, you know, frenetic energy on their feet and all that sort of thing. And we raised a lot of money, both in terms of the concert itself, but also the fundraising that was around it. And it was to sustain the strike. And if you remember, the government had moved against the NUM, frozen its assets. It had to depend upon for any form of financial support from the fundraising that was going on. And there was a tremendous atmosphere of solidarity. And at the time, everything the NUM said about the closure of the pits, the destruction of communities, everything that was predicted, that's exactly what the Tories did. So that strike was fundamentally important, not just for the miners, but for the whole working class. It was heroic struggle. I'll never ever forget the sort of heroism that went on, both in terms of the miners were on strike themselves, but remember the key, the backbone to the dispute as well, was the women against the pit closures, the way in which they mobilised and organised whole communities, fed the money that was raised and the food that was raised to keep people going, and the levels of violence on the picket line is extraordinary. You know, people like Ian Lavery, who's in the House of Commons now, you know, serves time. They were locked up, beaten up, there were a lot, you know. So when Style Council did this, it was a huge contribution to keeping morale up during the dispute, but also fundraising as well. And if you listen to the song itself, it's about what's happening in South Yorkshire. And if you remember at that time, they were blocking roads to prevent pickets moving about the country. Then they were arresting people and people were being imprisoned because they'd broken the curfews that were taking place. And the physical brutality was immense. But what Paul did in that song, he related it to what was happening in apartheid South Africa as well. So it was an internationalist song as well. Absolutely brilliant, absolutely. And a brilliant artist, a brilliant group at the time. But it just gave us, that concert gave us such a boost when times were pretty rough, pretty hard, you know. So I'll never forget it. And the music that came from that period, it was inspirational and still is.
I think in a way this show's about trying to get people, the feelings about certain political issues, they get to you through music a lot of the time. I mean, it's very evocative watching that video of the miners' strike and hearing the lyrics, and you know, sometimes that's as key as listening, reading a book or anything like that.
I think it's one of the best forms of communication, but also mobilization as well. And actually, it creates you associate with the music, you associate an emotion with the issue and then the action that's taken place. And what came out of that song was obviously it was a condemnation of the way that the miners were being treated, but also what was happening in South Africa. And it brought about that feeling of international solidarity as well. That was the other thing about the miners' strike. People forget now is just the scale of global support that came in from miners and trade unions right there across the globe. It was tremendous. I always remember working for the NUM, one or the other. The NUM was sort of, the reason Thatcher took on the NUM is because they were the Praetorian Guard of the trade union movement. She thought, if you can smash the NUM, you can smash the movement overall. And that was the whole strategy. I can remember the Grunwick dispute, which is wasn't far off from my constituency here. And I can remember being on the picket lines there month in, month out, where our constituency would send a delegation down every week. And that was violent when the buses were coming through. There were fights and the police were beating people up. And the guy who was one of our parliamentary candidates had a face smashed and blood all over the place, etc. But I can remember the morning when it was looking pretty grim at the Grunwick picket line. I can remember all of a sudden there was a noise, and literally you had a whole phalanx of miners marching with the banners and all the rest, and 5,000 miners turned up. It was unbelievable. 5,000 of them marched along. It was just phenomenal. But again, you know, to be frank, nowadays that solidarity hasn't gone away. You know, we're seeing some of the, it's difficult during COVID obviously, but you're seeing disputes taking place and people standing up and fighting back and solidarity being expressed as a result of that. That tradition hasn't gone. We've got to build on it. But the way you build on it is to remind people of the history of it. And part of the history of it is the music.
Yeah, well, right. So moving on now to your first book, which is E.P. Thompson's The Making of the English Working Class, which is a seminal book. I mean, I think probably most people have heard of it. I haven't actually read it, to be honest, but I'm sure it's worth reading. Do you want to tell us more about that?
Okay. You asked me for some books that were, if you like, inspirational or form my views. And I completely ignored you, to be honest, because if we were doing that, we'd have a capital working group set up and it'd take a few nights, basically, but what I thought I'd do is I'd choose three books that I'd recommend people to read, okay? The Making of the English Working Class, E.P. Thompson, has been around for quite a while, and it's become one of the fundamental books about the history of the movement overall. And the reason I'm recommending this is because I can remember reading it as a student years back and drawing upon it. But then at the beginning of the lockdown, the last lockdown, way back in March, April, I noticed on Twitter there were a group of people talking about reading The Making of the English Working Class as a book, E.P. Thompson's work. And I discovered that there was a book club that had been set up specifically to read it. And it was set up by a group around the Jacobin book journal in America. And there's two young academic activists, Alex Press, her, and Guy Winant. And what they did is they had a book club set up where you'd read a chapter a month or a chapter a fortnight or whatever, and then they'd interview people on it as well. So I joined the book club to reread the thing again. And what it does, from the early stages of the formation of the working class, it describes in some detail the history of that period in the 18th century into the development into the 19th century. And it's E.P. Thompson, Marxist historian, there was a part of the New Left Review group, huge breakthrough in how we understand class formation. And it's the making of the English working class. The class is a moving phenomenon, and you have to understand in different circumstances the different elements of what makes up a class and how it comes together. And what this does, it demonstrates how our class came together in this country, and just also you learn the lessons about how elements of our movement now are rooted back in those formations, those individual struggles. So anyway, I participated in the book club, the online book club that was set up, and it was just fascinating. It really was, and we had a discussion about different elements of the way in which ideas were formed as a result of the individual struggles, and the way in which the organisation of our class evolved, and how the trade union movement came about, how the different forms of solidarity action that was taken, and the breadth of working class involvement in possibly the most difficult of times, when people were working all hours God sent just to survive, had very limited resources, but found forms of communication which brought people together in solidarity as part of that struggle. So I think it's a fundamentally important book that people should read, but also if people are interested, I think maybe use it again as we did last year as part of a book club formation, in that way you can discuss the individual elements of it.
So where did you find this book club? Where is it online?
Sorry? It was online, yeah. And I think you can, if you go to Jacobin, the American journal, it was part of an initiative that came from a group there, yeah.
Oh, okay.
Oh, well, if necessary, I'll dig it out for you, and you can then put it in one of your chats at a future meeting, yeah.
Yeah, it sounds like a good idea, book club. So we've got your next song, which is... Christie Moor, which I'll play now.
And 10 years before I saw the light of morning, a comradeship of heroes was laid. From every corner of the world came sailing the 15th International Brigade. They came to stand beside the Spanish people, to try and stem the rising fascist tide. Franco's allies were the powerful and wealthy. Frank Ryan's men came from the other side. Even the olives were bleeding as the battle for Madrid thundered on. Truth and love against the force of evil, brotherhood against the fascist clan. Viva la Quinta Brigada, no pass around the pledge that made them fight. Adelante is the crier of the hillside. Let us remember them tonight. And Bob Hillard was a Church of Ireland pastor. From Killarney across the Pyrenees he came. From Derry came a brave young Christian brother. Side by side they fought and died in Spain. And Tommy Woods, aged 17, died in Cordoba. But with the Fianna he learned to hold a gun. From Dublin to the Villa del Rio, where he fought and died beneath the Spanish sun. Viva la Quinta Brigada, no pass around the pledge that made him fight. Adelante is the cry around the hillside. Let us remember them tonight.
Viva la Quinta Brigada, 1984, Christie Moore. About solidarity, again, it's another solidarity example with Irish people going to fight in the Spanish Civil War. I mean, to me, to think of going to another country and fighting in another war would just seem extraordinary.
Yeah. Because you were so appallingly restrictive in how many discs I could choose, how many songs I could choose, only seven, I was trying to combine something from an Irish artist, because of my family's Irish background, with also something related to international struggles and the Spanish Civil War's international solidarity struggle. And interestingly enough, on the Spanish Civil War, there was one of the veterans who lived in our borough, Bob Walker, who was famous for... Part of his role in the International Brigade. And when the dictator, when Franco fell in Spain, a number of them, including him, went back and were honoured for the work, the role that they played in fighting against fascism. But the reason I chose that is, one, because it was such an important struggle. When we were on the GLC, Ken Livingston, who was instrumental in making sure that we had a tribute established on the South Bank to the International Brigade, honour what they did. And it was a significant moment in the 30s, if you remember, where it was the first fight against fascism, where people from all over the world joined International Brigades, and there's a large number from Ireland. But unfortunately, as Christie refers to it, there's also fascists who went there from Ireland as well, to our eternal disgrace. But the reason for choosing Christie as well and combining that, Christie Moore is one of the best Irish singers in recent generations. He's absolute phenomenal in terms of a performer as well. But also, I always remember I chaired the Guildford Four Committee, and when we ran the campaign to secure the freedom of the Guildford Four, Christie supported us and actually did a concert for us as well. And at that point in time, that took some courage. Because anyone who was standing up on any issues around Irish prisoners, you can imagine what the media did to them at that time, and also what risks they were taking. But he did that, and I, as I say, really grateful for what he did. The whole family were, and eventually we won the campaign and freed them. It was an absolute miscarriage of justice, and they were innocent, but it did affect their lives. Well, you never lose that scar of, you know, that number of years in prison, and the loss of, not just the loss of your freedom, but the mental and physical struggles that they went through as a result of abuse in prison too. But no, Christie stood up for us, and it was great. And this, that song, I just, as you say, combines international solidarity. And you can feel with pride, really, just how people came forward from a number of countries, socialists, to stand in one of the, I think, one of the most fundamental battles pre the rise. Well, it was confronting fascism, and it obviously what then happened was the Second World War and the defeat of fascism eventually. But these are the people that identified the threat and stood up the earliest, and gave that many of them gave their lives for it courageously.
Yeah, it sounds extraordinary to me that, you know, to go to another country, especially when no one really went abroad in those times anyway. It was sort of, you know, to go to Spain now, everyone's a big deal, but it wasn't like that in the 30s. But I want to move on to your next book, because it does actually resonate with what you said about people being jailed unjustly. I had no idea about this until I searched it when you gave me the list. And it's Ronan Bennett's book, The Catastrophist. And I didn't know who Ronan Bennett was, but having read about his life, it's quite extraordinary what he's gone through and what he's achieved.
Ronan's a brilliant author. He's absolutely brilliant author. And also, he's a brilliant scriptwriter. And he's now well famous in terms of the work he does in TV and film. His latest, as people might have seen on television, is Top Boy, about drugs and young black people in the East End. It's absolutely brilliant. It's become incredibly popular. But he's done a series of novels as well. And this was one of his early ones, Catastrophist. And it's about what happened in the Congo, the assassination of Mumumba at that time. And again, it's a fascinating novel. It involves the sort of an understanding of the history of that period, particularly around colonialism and the way in which, in many instances, injustices occurred, but life was cheap as well. Assassinations went on continuously. I think he's a great writer. The way I met Ronan, and I'll do this briefly. What happened was, is when we were involved in the Guildford Four campaign, we set up a new legal team, and we had Mike Fisher and others, Gareth Pierce, etc. And we needed someone to do some research. And one of the lawyers recommended this young lad called Ronan Bennett. And he was finishing his PhD. And his PhD was in, I think, 17th century English law around the Civil War period. Anyway, we were told he was a good researcher. And then what happened was is that we asked Ronan, would he do it? He said, of course. And we needed someone to go through all the documentation that would find the evidence to ensure that we secured the prisoners' freedom. The reason Ronan was good is because he's not just a good researcher, but he'd also been arrested in Northern Ireland on a murder charge. He'd also been arrested over here on a murder charge, and on both occasions, defending himself, exposed that he was innocent. Even though they'd been locked up for quite a while, he exposed he was innocent, and he was just targeted by the state for a period of time. So he had that experience of being able to win in the courts, but also he had to research. The irony of it was, we needed access to the House of Commons library. So I asked Ronan, could we go to the Commons? And I wasn't an MP at the time. And we went to see Chris Mullin, because he was working on the Birmingham Six campaign. And we had a cup of tea with Chris Mullin and said, could you help us? Because we need a parliamentary pass under your supervision, Chris, so it's all legit, to get access the House of Commons library. And Chris Mullin refused. He said, no, fair enough. But sitting at the next table was Jeremy Corbyn. So I leant over to Jeremy and said, Jeremy, have you got a spare parcel? Would you help us with it? He said, of course I will. Poor old Jeremy, what happened was he got Ronan the pass. Then about 4 weeks later, he's on the front page of The Sun, where Labour MPs gives pass to someone who's just been through court on several murder charges and all this. So you can imagine it, kind of. They never even mentioned that Rona was completely innocent and, you know, all this sort of thing, you know. So I felt I felt really bad I dropped Jeremy into that, in on that one. But he, you know what Jeremy is like, he was absolutely sound. But Ronan was part of that team that then discovered the evidence that then freed up the Guildford Four. What we then did, we asked him, would he write about the case? And he sat down with Paul Hill of the Guildford Four and wrote a book based upon the interviewing Paul and going through the experiences and all the rest. In some ways, it was like a therapy session for Paul as well to get it off the chest. And then having written that, people realised he could really write. And then he's done a series of novels since then, as I say, script writing. He's a brilliant writer, a wonderful artist in his own right in development of film, etc. But he's a committed socialist and also actually one of the most humble people as well. I don't think he ever realizes just how talented he is at times, but he is. Yeah.
Well, really interesting. I'd like to read that book to find out more about him. Sounds really fascinating. Right, your next track is Missa Luba, Sanctus. Right, now I hadn't heard of this song before, this tune. Can you tell me more about that?
Okay, I thought it was a nice follow-on from Ronan's book in relation to the Congo, but you'll have to forgive me this one. People may know I was brought up a Catholic, and in my teenage years I went off, I thought I had a vocation to be a Catholic priest, so what then happens is you get sent off for a Catholic boarding school and then on to a seminary and all the rest. I reached the age of 16, discovered girls and Marxism actually, and I'm no longer a Catholic, I'm an atheist. But I still miss the old hymns, and I still miss the old Catholic mass in Latin, which I had to learn. And I learned Latin that, and I still miss the old whiff of the incense through the thurible, that sort of thing. So it was part of my life. Catholicism was a strong part of my life as a child. You know, we'd go to mass every week. I'd be an altar boy and all that sort of thing. And I love liturgical music as well. But this Missa Luba became quite famous. This choir was quite famous for a period. But I think it was some of these were in a particular film, if I remember. The film If Sanctus was in it. It's just beautiful music, incredibly well performed. And up until then, church music had been very much stereotypical, traditional European choirs largely, and using the normal orchestral instruments. But here was an African choir came along, put it to real beats and put it to African traditional music. And it was just hugely, I thought, wonderful. So yeah, I find it quite inspirational. It's part of my background, part of the...
You don't think you'll go back to being a Catholic at any time?
No, although, what is it? Who's the Who was the, I've forgotten the comedian now, the old comedian who died and asked for the Bible just to see if there was any get outs, you know, that sort of thing. No, no. It's interesting, when you take a materialist view of the world and history, the sort of clouds that are taken away. I don't disrespect people who believe in a religion or have a belief system. That's up to them, but we come to our own conclusions. But there's something about traditional rites like music that I think is I find quite interesting. And in many ways, if you think about it, the way in which people express themselves, because of the dominance of religion and churches, was often through church music. And I've just been reading. About the English Civil War, whatever. And it's interesting how the way people expressed their political views was through, in many ways, a religious concepts and language, because that was what was the dominant paradigm at the time. And eventually they broke through it. I think there's elements of religious music that if you go back to it, I think quite beautiful in its own right. William Byrd was lived in my constituency 3 or 4 centuries ago, and how he survived under Elizabeth I is a miracle, because I think he still practiced the old religion, but because his music was so beautiful, he just about survived and got away with that without being chopped. But yeah, anyway, I urge people to listen to Missa Lou, because it's an African choir taking over a very much a European form of musical intervention, if you like.
Right. Now we're going to move on to your third book, which I was surprised about when I saw your list, which is Arthur Ransome's Coot Club, which I remember when I was a boy, but I haven't read it since then. Could you let us in on this one?
Okay. Look, as I said, I wanted three books to recommend to people to read. The reason I like Coot Club, people may know, I go sailing on the Norfolk Broads. I've a family, we have a hut and a mooring and a couple of boats, a bit of a mess at the moment, but they need a bit of doing up. There's a lot of work that needs doing on them, but a couple of sailing boats that we sail around the Broads on. I'm a dreadful sailor. People get off the water when they see me coming. And Cynthia and I argue over who's in charge at different times and which way to tack and all that sort of thing. But I love it because it just takes your mind off everything and you can really enjoy yourself. And also on the Broads, you can get right out into the countryside. And most of the time you're listening to the birds and things like that. Last time I took Bryn Davis out, my friend, I took him out on, and we were listening and watching the birds and got distracted and ran aground. That usually happens with me. But anyway, Coot Club is Arthur Ransome, who did Swallows and Amazons. He also did a few books about sailing on the Norfolk Broads. Coot Club is a children's book, but actually there's a lot in it, which I think is wonderful about the descriptions of wildlife and the Broads themselves. Also, it actually teaches you a lot about sailing too and how to sail. And it's his references in it is exactly to Potter Heigham and Rethstave, where we've got our hut and where we go sailing from. And it's just a lovely book. He's got a couple of others. One of them is a great book based in Norfolk and Suffolk called We Never Meant to Go to Sea. It's about a group of children who sailing down the river, then mist comes down, they find themselves sailing to Holland. But it's just wonderful. It's just nice sitting and reading it to your children or grandchildren or whatever. So anyone, whenever we go up there, if anyone comes and stays with us, I give them a copy of the Coot Club to read.
All right.
Arthur Ransome, interesting character as well politically, if people didn't know. When he was a young journalist, he was based in Russia during the Russian Revolution. Lenin took a lot of time talking to him and others. He knew all the Russian leaders, and he married Trotsky's secretary. Extraordinary, isn't it? Hey, how about that? You know, of course, that's written out of his history in Britain.
I didn't see that when I was reading the Swallows and Amazons. They never said he married Trotsky's secretary.
Well, he did a very good book, short book, about that period of the Russian Revolution, all based upon his own experiences there. But he had access to all the Russian leaders. In fact, he resided with a few of them over that period of time. Quite a remarkable cat. Yeah. Wow. And then he goes off and does all his sailing. And the thing about it, he writes incredibly well about sailing and fishing. I don't fish, but the sailing, I'm useless at, but I love, enjoy reading it and try and improve.
Oh, well, I'll have a look at that. Now, we're running out of time, so I'm going to move on to your next choice of music, which is Stormzy and Crown. Right, so Stormzy, he's a big supporter of Jeremy Corbyn. Have you met him yourself?
No, at a time when, funny enough, I just missed it. At a time when we needed support, he stuck with us. He really did. Seb Corbyn used to work with me. He would liaise with Stormzy, and anything that was asked, he'd be there. In fact, even I think when agents get in the way and all the rest of it, Stormzy would just, any support you want. And it was wonderful. And I just, a lot of admiration for him. But this song in particular, I think, is really moving because it, heavy is the head that wears the crown, quotes from Shakespeare, which he takes on board. And he goes through the song of all the different things he's done and the attacks that the media have had on him. Even when he set up that, when he put that money aside for young black kids to go to university, he even got attacked for that, And this is, I think, the song itself is quite heartrending when you listen to it. It's a brilliant song, but just out of solidarity, he was there when we needed him every time, and it comes across as a really decent person and someone who's very committed and socially conscious. That's wonderful. Interestingly enough, I was supported a group, there was a group last night called, a group of young black actors called Intermission. It's a thing supported by Mark Rylance, and Marcus supports them all throughout, and it gives opportunity of young black actors to perform. They've done it. Last night they took this heavy is the head that wears the crown concept as well, and they did a short film. It was absolutely brilliant. And each one of them was given a Shakespeare phrase in which they could develop a film around. And that's exactly what Stormzy is here. It's taken one expression from Shakespeare, seen how relevant it is, and then developed it into a song that's so personally relevant, but also actually quite meaningful to a large number of others. That's what those kids did last night, and it was just tremendous. It was just really moving. But no, I haven't met him, but he was such a strong supporter of Jeremy at a time when we needed it and others were fleeing from us. He was there. You'd never forget that.
I mean, that time when he was at Glastonbury, that actual concert, and he got everyone singing Jeremy Corbyn, that was amazing, wasn't it?
Yeah, I was there, and a number of, this is typical me, a number of people went backstage and that sort of thing. But I don't know, problem is, my job was always to get things done and stuff like that. So at times I'd always be called away to, get a report signed off or stuff like that. I was doing all the boring stuff. Oh. That was it, really. So I missed out on that, definitely. But you never know. You might be able to catch up at some time. But no, I just, absolute solidarity from him. But he's a wonderful artist, actually, if you listen to some of the stuff. I also appreciated, I don't know whether people heard his song, Vossi Bop, and it's absolutely brilliant. And there was a demonstration in Russell Square. And I came out of the tube and all these youngsters were there and they had an open top bus and they were playing Stormzy's Vossi Bop. And for people who know the song, the most delightful part of the song is the way in which they refer to Boris Johnson, but I won't use that language tonight.
All right. Well, we've come to the last of your songs, which is this one. It's Chumbawumba.
I'm not afraid to die.
Chumbawumba. That was a bit of a surprise to me, because I just didn't expect you to choose that. But the thing about that one, I remember they won an award, didn't they? And they threw water over John Prescott. That's something I remember about that one.
I'm sure he forgave them soon afterwards. Don't worry.
But it's got a great chorus.
He must have been hot. He needed it.
He didn't look very happy in that picture I saw.
No, he's mellowed since then. By the way, he's recovering from a stroke still. So, I've always sent my best wishes to him, and good luck to him. Hope he comes through it all well and back in himself. You know what that song's all about. It embodies our movement, doesn't it? Every time we get knocked down, we come back again. And many of the demonstrations and picket lines I've been on when we've played that, it's really inspired people. No matter what, they'll never defeat us. The workers united will never be defeated. And it comes through that song. They knock us down and we get up again.
Right. Well, it's interesting, because when Jeremy did this, he had that song, The Workers United Will Never Be Defeated, yeah. His last song. And you've got the updated version. No, it's
more eloquent than me, Jeremy, on things like this.
It was at the time, there was a lot of sort of charty poppy stuff, and that one sort of went in without any trouble. It got into number one, I think, at a certain point, which is good to see. Well, look, we've come to 8:30. So we've done an hour, but what I want to say is thank you very much for coming on, John. I think this is a great way to learn about history and politics and culture. I mean, I've learned just from reading about Arthur Ransome and Gil Scott Heron and, E.P. Thompson and Ronan Bennett, just for starters. I mean, I'll put all the names of the books and music out on an email to everyone who's here. And before we go, though, we could leave it with Chumbawumba, but I thought we'd ask Rob, who's here. Are you there?
Yeah, is Rob there?
Hello.
Oh, brilliant.
Hey, Rob, are you able to lead us out with the red flag?
Please. I would love to. Would love to. Lovely choice of music. The people's flag is deepest red. It's shrouded oft our martyr dead. And ere the limbs grew stiff and cold, their heart's blood dyed its every fold. So raise the scarlet standard high, beneath its shade we live or die. Though cowards flinch and traitors sneer, we keep the red flag flying here. It waved above our infant might, when all ahead seemed dark as night. It witnessed many a deed and vow, we shall not change its colour now. So raise the scarlet standard high, beneath its shade we live or die. Though cowards flinch and traitors sneer, we keep the red flag flying here. And it well recalls our trials past, and gives us hope of peace at last. This banner bright, this symbol plain, of human rights and humanity's gain. So raise the scarlet standard high, beneath its shade we live or die. Though cowards flinch and traitors sneer, we keep the red flag flying here. So raise the scarlet standard high, beneath its shade we live or die. Though cowards flinch and traitors sneer, we keep the red flag flying here.
Thank you, Rob.
Pleasure.
And thank you, John, again. And I just thought I'd let everyone know next week we're doing the same show, but this time not with John, because we've had his seven books and his three books and seven songs. Next week we've got Lindsay German of Stop the War. Find out what her recommendations are. I think she might have some interesting choices. Thank you, everyone, for coming. And thank you, Libby, for being co-host, letting people in. And see you on Sunday morning. We've got Not the Andrew Marr Show. And see you then. Okay. Bye for now.
Bye.
Bye. Bye-bye.